I'm pleased to introduce next speaker, Dr. Stefan Kappe. Dr. Stefan Kappe is from Seattle Medical Research Institute and the University of Washington. He's currently an assistant professor at the University of Washington and the associate member with Seattle Biomedical Research Institute. Dr. Kappe has done a very interesting work in the immune response against plasmodium falciparum infection at the liver stage. So the title of Dr. Kappe's talk is Back to the Future, Live Attenuated Malaria Vaccine by Design. Stefan.
I'm from Seattle Biomedical Research Institute and the University of Washington. If you don't know our institution, we are completely dedicated to eradicate infectious diseases of developing countries. We have programs in HIV, malaria, TB, and fungal pathogens. And it's a very interesting organization that is mainly, right now, I would say, 200 scientists focusing on those infectious agents. So we have seen this this statement before, and I just want to make a few more comments. I think really this has led to a seismic shift in the community, because before people were not thinking about eradication. And you have to understand that this has historic reasons. Eradication has failed before, or the eradication campaign has failed before, and it has failed very, very miserably. And I think people who remember this were burned and really didn't want to go there anymore and talk about and give promises that they couldn't maintain. But now, I think it's a new time. We have lots of funding. We have new tools. So I think it's an audacious goal, but I think we should pursue it. And the WHO certainly also thinks we should pursue it. I would also like to point out that Barack Obama has the audacious goal of eradicating malaria in 2015. But maybe in 4 years we can remind him of that. So if you want to think about eradicating malaria, in my opinion, and this is truly my opinion, you need an effective vaccine. You need a vaccine that protects at a high level, and a high level means probably more than 90%. And we have paradigms for this. We have eradicated diseases with vaccines such as smallpox. And I think all the efforts for malaria control are extremely important, because right now we do not have a vaccine, and we may not have a highly protective one in the next 5 to 10 years, who knows. But I think the magic word here is sustainability. How can we sustain such efforts? Because we do know that if we go and control malaria for a long period of time and bring down malaria to very few cases and then walk away because people think it's not a problem anymore, it can come back with a vengeance. And there's famous examples for this, such as Sri Lanka and other places, where within a couple of years after going from 1 million cases to nearly no cases and walking out, we had 1 million cases back very soon. When we think about eradication of malaria, we really have to think about the bottlenecks of the infection. Think about an invading army. At the point where the mosquito transmits this parasite, it transmits very few of those parasites. A few dozen get into your body. Once they take a hold in your body and they first go to the liver and infect your liver cells, they replicate. Each one makes tens of thousands of new infectious forms that infect your bloodstream. This is completely asymptomatic. The disease starts here. And once this cycle starts, you have billions and billions and billions of parasites in your bloodstream. That is extremely difficult to control. And the next bottleneck is here, and Joe has talked about transmission blocking vaccines, so I'm not going to go into details here, but the number of parasites actually transmitted back to the mosquito is also fairly low. So it's another great target where if you want to intervene successfully, you can probably do it at these points. The number of the enemy is relatively low. So let's think about vaccine development in a very simple way. There's two ways of making vaccines, really. And one is you take a pathogen and you identify what makes this pathogen, and then you take a piece of it, let's say an individual protein, and you vaccinate with it. And then you get the whole pathogen invading your body, and your immune response recognizes one component of this pathogen and hopefully effectively eliminates it. There's another strategy, and this is really the oldest strategy in vaccinology, and that is you take the whole organism. You just take the whole thing. You don't even ask what's in there. You just make it weak so it doesn't cause disease, or you kill it, and then you immunize with the whole thing. And then if the real invader comes in, there's multiple immune responses against multiple targets that will eliminate the invader. So this has traditionally been a much more successful approach, and you can see why, because you have really a much more robust multi-component immune response that can attack the organisms. This is very very sensitive to a number of things. One is, for instance, mutations. If the parasite or the virus or the bacterium mutates the sequence of such a protein, you will not get an effective immune response anymore. Think about influenza, for instance. Every year you have to make a new influenza vaccine because the virus mutates and you don't know what next year will bring. So traditionally, these vaccines have been very successful. And this is really reflected in the portfolio of vaccines that we have. So here are all the FDA licensed vaccines for 23 pathogens. You can see 16 of those are whole organism vaccines. Some of our most successful vaccines, polio, yellow fever, Joe talked about some of those, are whole organism vaccines. These are either life attenuated, meaning that the organism is not dead, it's just weakened, or they are inactivated, they are killed, then they are truly dead. And the problem with malaria, as I will show you, is that dead malaria vaccines don't work, so we have to attenuate them somehow. So what about malaria? Well, we do know that we can protect against malaria. We can protect against malaria by taking this initial transmission stage, the sporozoite, and attenuating it. And this is a seminal paper by Ruth Nussenzweig in 67, showing that if you attenuate the sporozoite by irradiation, by basically damaging its DNA, and then immunizing animals with such sporozoites, you can induce complete protection. So if you give an infectious sporozoite challenge, then these animals never become blood stage infected, so they never become sick. And this was demonstrated in humans as well in the 70s at the University of Maryland and other places, Walter Reed Army Institute of Research, that you can immunize humans with irradiated sporozoites and can completely protect them from infection. So we do have a paradigm of a protective malaria vaccine. I think, again, it's a misconception that we do not understand how we can protect against malaria. I think we can protect against malaria. We can protect against infection. It's an anti-infection vaccine. But radiation attenuation, there are lots of issues surrounding radiation attenuation. Here are some that I have listed. Too much, you give too much irradiation and you get no protection. A dead malaria parasite vaccine doesn't work. It's unlike other pathogens. We cannot protect with a dead parasite. If you give too little, you get an infection because the parasite can make it into the liver, can replicate and release infectious merozoites into the bloodstream, so the vaccine actually makes you sick. It's not good. There's a lot of issues with what I call heterogeneous genetic identity. You don't really know what you make every time you make it. Every time you irradiate something, you damage DNA in a different way. And there is actually some evidence that this can lead to increased virulence, and this is obviously a very sensitive issue. You don't want to make a vaccine that suddenly becomes even more dangerous than the pathogens that you want to fight in the first place. So what we have been focusing on is genetic engineering, and this is really something in the vaccine field of life-attenuated vaccines that people try to do now in viral vaccines, in bacterial vaccines. But for parasitic diseases or for a malaria vaccine, it's never been really considered, and you just need to think about David Ruth's presentation with these thousands and thousands and thousands of genes. The major question is, how do you attenuate it by genetic engineering if you have so many things to look at? 5,000, 6,000 genes, what do you take out in order to weaken the organism? But if you can do it, there's advantages. It's consistently attenuated, always gets the same thing. It's defined. So from a regulatory standpoint, it's also very important. The Food and Drug Administration likes defined products. It's reproducible, and it has a uniform genetic identity. So it's not some bug that can go in either way, higher virulence or less virulence. It has a defined characteristics because it's defined genetically. So how do you do this? When you look at the parasite in the mosquito, there's a very interesting phenomenon, and I try to make this as simple as possible. The sporozoite stage that you heard about, it develops in the gut of the mosquito, and then it infects the salivary glands. And here you see the mosquitoes expressing or carrying parasites that express a green fluorescent marker. But when you take those directly out of the cradle, so to speak, and inject them into an animal, they cannot infect the animal. But if you take them out of the salivary glands, they are highly infectious. So you have no infection and you have high infection. Well, the question then is, on the genetic level, how is this regulated? So you use microarrays, gene chips. You have seen this before, and we find many, many genes that are actually highly induced when the parasite becomes infectious to the mammalian host. And these are our targets for attenuation. We also ask another question, and that is, what genes are expressed after the parasite infects your liver, a hepatocyte? And I have to point out, these are mouse models of malaria, so we can actually work in the laboratory with this, but I would argue it's not significantly different in human malaria parasites. So we can isolate these parasites from the liver and ask directly what genes are turned on in these stages of liver infection. And this sounds trivial, but people have tried to do this for 50 years, so we were very actually happy that finally we could get a hand on this stage of the parasite, which, as you can imagine, if you get a few dozen parasites in the liver, finding them in the liver is extremely difficult. But if you can isolate them, that's good. So we, again, use gene chips, microarray analysis, to determine the expression patterns of these, and I'm not going to go into the details here. Suffice it to say that each of these stages at different time points of its development inside the hepatocyte expresses 1,000 or more genes. So how do we attenuate? There's different types of attenuation we can envision, and here's one. The parasite, when it sits inside your liver cells, shields itself by wrapping itself in a membrane. And inside these membranes are proteins that help the parasite exchange material with the host. So these are proteins we are looking at here. Here's a parasite in the liver, and you can see the proteins we are talking about sit in this membrane around the parasite. So we delete these parasites by genetic deletion, and we can completely excise those genes from the genome using transfection and gene targeting technologies, and we can then identify the deletion appropriately by PCR. And here it shows you what happens to the parasite when these genes are deleted. So here's a normal parasite, and you can see it's big, it's developing, it's starting to grow. And here are the ones that we delete the genes from. You can see they don't grow, so they get stuck. They can infect the liver, but they can't grow. That's great. We have attenuated the parasite. We have made an attenuated parasite. Is it a vaccine? And yes, it is. So here you can see some immunization experiments in mice, not in humans, in mice, where you take a single dose of these attenuated strain, of this particular attenuated strain, immunize the mouse, and challenge the mouse a week later with 10,000 infectious sporozoites. This is a high overdose of infection. In a natural transmission situation, you would see maybe a few dozen parasites transmitted. You get complete protection, and this is complete sterile protection. No blood stages ever occurring in these mice, and all the mice protect 100%. So you can also do this after 30 days, and you get complete protection. And you can immunize three times and then try to infect the mouse after 180 days, and you still get complete protection. So for vaccines, the importance is not only that you protect initially, but that you protect for a long time. And this is 180 days for the life of a mouse is quite a long period of time. We don't know yet how this translates into human vaccination, but I think these data look very encouraging. So we can also prevent the parasite from infecting the liver successfully, and these are proteins that are in this infectious stage and help it getting inside the host cell. And when we delete those, the parasite can get in the host cell, but it can't produce this protective wrapping around it, and therefore it cannot grow. Because it cannot grow, it cannot form these liver stages that make merozoites and infect the bloodstream. So here's a gene deletion mutant, the vaccine strain, and here's the normal parasite. And when we try to infect an animal with this, you really can get no infection, so these are safe vaccines. You don't see an infection based on the vaccination, and that's important. So even 100,000 units of this vaccine do not lead to infection, so this is a safely attenuated parasite. If you immunize, you get complete protection. So you can see, again, different immunization regimens, and you can get complete protection, long-lasting complete protection. And last but not least, we can target metabolism of the parasite. In this case, it's fatty acid metabolism. David Roos has talked about this somewhat. This is a pathway that the parasite needs to make lipids, okay? And if we target this pathway, we can, again, completely attenuate at specifically the liver stage, and you can see this here. If you inject a lot of these mutant parasites, you do not get blood stage infection. So again, they cannot make it through this initial phase of the liver cycle. They get stuck at this phase. And the interesting thing about this particular attenuation strain is that it doesn't get stuck early in development, as I've shown you for the other strains. It gets stuck late in development. It actually cannot make these new infectious forms. It cannot make these new infectious merozoites. These are the little balls that you can see here. Each of those is a new infectious unit that can infect a red blood cell, and you can see this mutant strain cannot make them. So they are attenuated very late in the liver cycle, and they cannot infect your bloodstream. And again, they are completely protective, and these are actually some of the most protective strains we have developed so far. And the reason is because they actually grow for a while in the liver, express many, many new antigens that are target of effective immune response. So we are very excited because, as my title implies, we can actually design these vaccines. We can, by gene targeting, by introducing precise deletions into the genome of the parasite, we can tweak the way this parasite behaves as a vaccine. So it goes into the liver, stops, or it goes into the liver and grows a little bit, or it goes into the liver and grows a little bit more. Each of this has important implications for the immune response that eliminate an incoming parasite. So this is a kind of a new concept, but I think very, very exciting and worthwhile pursuing, because in the end, what we want to have a vaccine that can protect with one or two doses, maybe three, and you don't need much of it if you vaccinate. So you need a low dose per low unit number per dose, and you need as few doses as possible, and the protection should be as long-lasting as possible. This is a completely different way of making vaccines when compared to subunit vaccines, where you try to kind of build this up. Here you kind of take out, and so it's an interesting concept, I think, that deserves some more attention. So this just shows you that we can make these vaccine strains behave differently in the initial infection, asymptomatic infection, and therefore have different potencies as a vaccine. So what about Plasmodium falciparum? What I've showed you were rodent models of the malaria parasites that we use in the laboratory. It's very convenient. You can test vaccines very easily because you can challenge those animals. You can actually expose them to the infectious agent. In Plasmodium falciparum, it's not that easy to test vaccines, but I disagree with Joe, who said that there is no possibility of challenging humans with malaria. You can actually do this, and I'll show you how we do this. So, but before I show you this, I just show you that we have created the first attenuated lines in Plasmodium falciparum. This is very difficult technology. It takes a long time to do, 8 months to a year to make a single strain of these vaccines. But you can do this pretty much the same way as I've showed you before, by completely excising the genes from the genome. And then you can test this by genetic fingerprinting, and you can show that these strains have this particular gene missing from their genome. And then you can show that these are attenuated. This is a lot of data. I'm not going to go into detail. Just focus on this part here. If you infect hepatocytes in a culture dish with these strains, these parasites don't grow. The normal wild-type parasites, the regular parasites, grow very well. These parasites don't grow. But they get into the cell and they start developing, but they don't grow. This is in vitro assay of vaccine potency, so to speak. So we have this first strain ready to go into the clinic, and I want to tell you briefly how you can actually test these vaccines, because I think many people don't know this model, and I think it's nice. It's a nice model to test vaccines rapidly, and also it allows you to volunteer for those trials, which I encourage you all to do. So at SBRI, for instance, we infect mosquitoes with Plasmodium falciparum by membrane feeding, so the parasite is inside the mosquito, and then you actually expose yourself to the infectious bite. And anybody fainting? It's actually a model that has been used for a long time. In the last 30 years of vaccine development, which has not been very successful in terms of the vaccine development, we have challenged over 900 volunteers in different institutions in this country, and none of these was ever hospitalized for disease. The vaccines were not protective, but what you can do, because these are drug-sensitive strains, you can treat the volunteers upon first occurrence of parasitemia, occurrence of parasites in the blood. And these can be done in a way that you're mostly asymptomatic when you detect those parasites first in the blood. You're treated with an antimalarial drug, and you're cured. So it's actually a relatively safe model. There are risks associated with it, but it's a relatively safe model. And as I said, malaria vaccines have been tested before with this vaccine, and some of them have shown partial protection. Some of them have shown no protection. We don't have a completely protective vaccine except the sporozoite vaccine. So we will actually test our genetically engineered strains in this model by testing first the safety, by exposing individuals to this vaccine and asking, is it safe? Does it cause infection or not? And then once we know it's safe, hopefully, we will immunize with this vaccine, and then we will challenge with infectious mosquitoes. As I've shown you before, a little cup of infected mosquitoes on your arm, and then clinical follow-up and monitoring for blood stage parasitemia. And obviously, you have to produce these parasites under GMP, which is not easy. It's such a unique model, but we have actually accomplished doing this. So we hope to be in clinical trials and have FDA approval by mid-next year and go into the trials in the third quarter, fourth quarter of next year. So I think this model is a very powerful model and actually allows you to down-select vaccines very rapidly, be it live-attenuated vaccines or be it subunit vaccines. And we have actually established a malaria challenge center at Seattle Biomedical Research Institute. So again, if feel free to volunteer for those trials. And if you have asked yourself during this session, how can I help with malaria eradication, I think this is one of the best ways you can do it, by volunteering for those trials. So these live-attenuated vaccines have obviously issues associated with them, and the biggest issue is how do you manufacture them and how do you deliver them? And I don't have time to go through this. There is really huge formidable issues associated with this, but we have produced live-attenuated vaccines before. It's not unheard of. We have made them in eggs. We have made them in mouse brains, and we have made them in even worse things than that, and I'm not going to talk about this. So I do think that we can make. This is my laboratory in Seattle, and many, many collaborators for a long period of time. And this live-attenuated vaccine project is funded through the Grand Challenges in Global Health Initiative, and it's a great example of how you can move rapidly basic science into clinical application, and we are really extremely fortunate to be able to do this with these significant funds. So basically, when you think about it, the project has started 3.5 years ago from the lab bench, and next year we are in the clinic. That's actually an extremely ambitious timeline when you think about drug and vaccine development. And I'll end here. Thank you.